So those of you who follow me on Google Plus, you'll know that I've recently moved house again and I'm in the middle of setting up the new lab here so I can start shooting videos again. But over the weekend I took a few things to the local charity shop that we didn't need anymore and actually spied this behind the counter in a big green box with some other electrical items. Now the lady told me it was in the box there because it was actually faulty. They plugged it in and nothing happened, it didn't work, and all they did was actually just check the fuse in the plug. But it was left in the box because it was going to be picked up. There's a guy apparently comes around once a week and picks up all their electrical items that obviously don't work. Now she did tell me that she couldn't sell me this, but she would let me have it if I put a donation into the tin at the front of the counter, and that way she wasn't breaking any rules and actually selling me it. She was actually giving it to me and I was giving her a donation. So I actually donated £20 because even if this doesn't work, I know that I can get at least double that on eBay if I put it on eBay as just spares and repairs and not powering on. So as I said, this is a video that I actually didn't plan to shoot, but what I'm going to do is actually crack this open and see if we can see anything wrong with it. Any of the capacitors have blown, or maybe even the internal fuse has blown, that's actually stopping this from working. Now this unit is actually, it looks brand new. It doesn't look like it's had any wear and tear at all. It didn't come with any leads, of course, it was just this unit here. And the lady at the charity shop said it came with a bag of clothes and an old toaster and a kettle. And this was in the box as well. So I don't know if it's been given to the charity shop by mistake or not. I've got no idea, but it's not something that anybody who would have bought this would be into electronics. And I'm pretty sure it wouldn't be something that somebody would throw away. So let's get on to the bench and we'll crack this open and see if there's anything in there that is damaged and we could maybe replace and get ourselves a working oscilloscope. So it is made by Hantek and it is the 5072p, the 2-channel 70 megahertz oscilloscope. And I do know that a guy called Tinhead on the EEV blog forums has shown you how to hack one of these up to 200 megahertz. He's done a couple of tutorials on there and they are really easy to follow. So if I get this working, I probably will be hacking it up to 200 megahertz. So looking at the front of it, it does look brand new. It doesn't seem to have any wear on the switches at all. You usually get a little bit of grime on some of these actual knobs that you twist quite regularly, but it has very little use. So if we do manage to get this booted up, it'd be interesting to see how many times in the firmware it should show us how many times it's actually been switched on. So getting into this is real easy. You've just got two Phillips screws at the bottom here near the actual flipping out legs, and there's another two behind the handle at the top there. And the screws at the top behind the handle are a little bit trickier. You've got to hold the handle at a slight angle, just long enough to get the screw past the little ridge on that handle. So hopefully now I should just be able to lift the back off and then we can get a look inside. So straight away I can spot the problem here. We've got a big beefy capacitor on the 240 volt side of this switch mode power supply and it's missing. You can see there we've just got the base in place and the top looks like it's just blown off. Now I'm playing a little bit of a detective game here because the person who would normally buy an oscilloscope would be a person who's obviously into electronics. And I can see here we've got some of the innards from the actual capacitor blown out here in the little corners. We've got the little bit of telltale fluff there, and we've also got some of the fluff over here by the fan. So they've obviously opened this up because the rest of the capacitor is missing. When I shook it before I actually took it to pieces, it wasn't rattling around or anything like that. So I really cannot understand why this has ended up in a charity shop. I would have thought somebody who was into electronics could quite easily swap that capacitor out. So maybe they already have done once and it's blown again, so they've just given up. I don't know, but These oscilloscopes tend to go around the £200 mark here in the UK, and it's a lot of money just to throw away, so I really don't understand that at all. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to go online and find out what value that capacitor should be, because obviously we've got nothing here that we can read. And I'm also actually going to take a look at this fuse as well to make sure that hasn't been blown. But apart from that, I can't see anything else that might be wrong with this particular power supply. I can't see any scoring or burning from any other components. And the rest of the capacitors here on the low voltage side, they all seem intact. There's no bulges or anything like that, and there's obviously none of them missing at all. So yeah, I think I'll find out the value and replace that and add some power and see what happens. You never know, it might just blow again, but that's going to take a little bit more detective work to find out what's wrong. But even so, I'm sure you could go on eBay and get a complete unit sent to you. There must be Chinese sellers on eBay actually sell these, and could get hold of one of these for you, and actually you could do a deal with them and get one pretty cheap. I mean, at the end of the day, this is probably the cheapest part of the entire oscilloscope. So again, I don't know why somebody would just throw this away. So I had a quick look online, and there's lots of information about these scopes, and according to the schematic, it's a 400 volt 100 UF capacitor, and I've got one here. But the one I've got here in the workshop is not quite as fat and chunky as the original one. But it should be okay as a direct replacement. It's the same values and everything, just the diameter is slightly less than the original one. But we've got no worries about height or anything here, so we can just put this in. It should work just fine. So it'll be interesting if it is just a matter of swapping out that capacitor again. If somebody who buys this is into electronics, I don't know why it was actually in the charity shop. So it looks like the board is just held in with some Phillips screws here, but I'm going to remove some of the power connectors here so we can actually turn the board over and remove the internal fan here. But I'm going to actually leave this in place. I think that's soldered down anyway, but we should be able to just remove the Phillips screws and then flip it over so we can actually work on there on the back with the soldering iron to remove this old capacitor and solder our new one in. So I've got the new capacitor soldered in there, and you can't really go wrong because you've got a big X marks the spot there for the actual positive lead. I'm looking around this power supply. It is a quite neatly done power supply. It's quite well designed for creepage, so yeah, it's not too bad at all. It's probably just been let down by using slightly cheaper no brand name capacitors. So I'm just mounting the power board back in place here, and I did forget to mention I have checked this fuse, and it's still fine. It's intact, so the fuse hasn't blown. So hopefully it's just that capacitor. And yes, I have gone around this board and really had a really close look with the magnifying glass, and I can't see anything else wrong with it. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we've got ourselves a working oscilloscope. So I've got the board in place, and I've cleaned all that fluff out of the oscilloscope. And normally I would actually just leave the back off like this and give it a quick test. Of course, being really careful, I mean, there's high voltages around here. But I don't particularly want a party popper going off in my lab if it is indeed a fault which keeps popping good capacitors there on the high voltage rail. But what I'm going to do is pop the back on before I turn it on, and then that should contain any mess that might happen if it does indeed pop again. Now, if you remember me saying I didn't get any leads with this, but it's just a standard kettle lead for the actual power. So I'm going to power it on for the first time. And even when you know that there's a risk that it might pop, it still makes you jump if it does. We've got lights on the front. And it's powering up. So it definitely looks like it's working. So I'm pretty pleased with that. So let's get some leads and plug them in, and we'll have a little look, see if it actually displays a waveform. Now, unfortunately, the only probes that I've got are some 20 megahertz probes that I have on my analog scope, and I've got a couple of analog scopes. I've got a 10 megahertz one and a 20 megahertz one, so I will have to actually purchase some new probes, because as I said, it didn't come with anything else. But we can just use it to do a quick check. The auto set, and there we go. So we'll check the second channel. There we go, both channels seem to be working fine. I will actually run this for a while and see if we get any kind of response from that capacitor. Maybe it might blow again over time, I don't know, but it all seems to be working fine. Looks like I've got myself a fully working scope for £20 and a little bit of time. But of course I'll have to buy some leads, and I'll probably buy some better quality leads that you might have got with this originally, but definitely well worth £20. So I hope you enjoyed this little repair video. It was really quite simple, just that one capacitor, and I am going to hack this up to 200 megahertz, so another reason why I'm going to get some new probes. I'll have to get some 200 megahertz probes obviously to go with that, but yeah, nice little unit. It's not something I originally wanted to buy. I was quite happy using my analog scopes here in the lab for the kind of work that I do. If I do want to do something that's a little bit beyond my analog scopes, I tended to take it into school and hook it up to their oscilloscopes. But for using, you know, for general purpose in the lab, I'm sure this is going to work out just fine. So as I say, I hope you enjoyed this video and you found it useful. And again, I have no idea why this ended up in the charity shop with such a simple repair, but yeah, hopefully you'll join me on the next one.